My name is Reeves Lehman, and I am, you remember me? And I am the chairman of the Film, Video, and Animation Department at the School of Visual Arts, and I welcome you here tonight. And I want to say something really important, because why do we do these things? I mean, this is our theater. It's not free by any means. You know, there's a budget that we have to adhere to. But I think it's extremely important to provide events or opportunities for animation, the animation community, to come together. Whether you are from this realm or period where it influenced so many animators, and few of them teach at the School of Visual Arts, to the student walking in to our school with the dream of becoming an animator, either independent or working for the studios. And I am really committed to doing as many events as possible to bring the animation community of New York here together, so you can not only meet, but exchange ideas and alert each other to opportunities that exist out there, because there are many. And it's only because there are no places like this that exist in Manhattan that we get this opportunity. So count on me to do as many as possible throughout the year to bring us all together of all ilks of animation, whether you're stop motion, computer, traditional, what have you. Saying that, I want to, we already did a couple of things here. We did Scribbles with Patrick Smith and Mr. Plimpton, you know, who has been a big supporter of SVA, and he takes on a lot of students as interns and so forth. But what I have upcoming is on October 24th, later this month, we have the Show of Shows, which is Ron Diamond's search around the world for what he subjectively sees as the best animation, and we'll bring it here that night, and we'll have in the larger theater, actually, because it gets quite a crowd. We want to show that animation from around the world, which is a wonderful opportunity, and I hope you spread the word and that you actually attend it. And that's coming on, as I said, October 24th in the evening, and we want that to be a very successful event, another opportunity for you to kind of mingle and just shake hands or whatever. And then, for the very, very first time in this country, I had a meeting with a representative from Annecy. And we are going to do the best of Annecy here at this theater, which I think is the fact that we have that opportunity really is a feather in our cap. So, and that will be the evening of February 8th, and we will put it out there as much as we can, but if you happen to get the email, please forward it to as many people as you can. We really, as I said, I am totally committed to doing this more and more, but I can't do it alone. You know, I don't want to be a voice in the wilderness here. I really want all of us to think of SVA as the center for communicating to the animation community and creating a community here in New York. So, having said that, I want to introduce the man who is the, I guess, the host of the whole evening. I mean, this is an ASIFA event, but his name is Tom Warburton. Is that Burton?
That's the
word
that they send the missile
call. That war, I'm a veteran, so kind of that scared me, that word. So are you going to come up here?
I'm going to go from here. I'm just going to go from
you
here.
You are?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right, so let the evening begin, and thank you all for coming.
Thank you very much, SBA, for having us here. My name is Tom Warburton, and while I did not have the honor of working at Perpetual Motion, you can tell because I'm young and beautiful. But seriously, it's wonderful for that all you came out here for this gathering, a remembrance, just a way for everyone to remember this great studio that was such a force from 1968 for about 12 years after that. This was a story about two guys who met at a place called Stars and Stripes and got together and decided to make their own studio. And it got bigger and bigger, and so many people from the animation world in New York passed in and out of this place and did so much different work from commercials to long form, and it was just an amazing bunch of work. But we brought some of the people who worked there. Mordecai Gerstein, designer, director, I mean, just an amazing children's book author. Candy Kugel, my first boss. She was the youngest person to be working at Perpetual Motion and started very early on there, and one of the very few female animators in the city, in general in animation. Tani Schlamme, producer, started out as an editor at the studio and is now a big shot Hollywood TV guy, West Wing. Yes. Next, J.J. Sedelmaier, another of my bosses. JJ started us, that was his first job, and started out as an assistant animator or in-betweener, yep. And he now has JJ Sedelmaier Productions out in White Plains, which has done, yeah. And Russell Calabrese, who also started, you started out as an in-betweener as well?
I started out as a general apprentice.
General apprentice, so.
He had to do everything.
Yes, but he was at least a general first. He didn't start out as a private, so you know, he was very high ranking. So we're going to start off with a little montage that Richard O'Connor has put together for us so masterfully, and to show you some of the things that went on at this studio. So let's roll that.
Hawaiian punch.
Sure.
You can get a cartoon cat to sing about cat food.
I'm ranting and raving for a cool
as I said, the studio was started by a producer and a designer. Now, Hal Silverman's was the art side of this. And he, like I said, he and Buzz met at Stars and Stripes. Hal Silverman's, I'd like to hear a little about from each of you. Could you each describe Hal with one word? Mordecai? I'll give you, you can have two if they're really good words. And you can't use the word delicious.
Unique.
Unique. Candy?
Incredibly versatile.
Okay. That's like 10 words. Stop. Versatile is great. Tommy?
The one that wasn't Buzz. The one.
Okay. JJ?
Over there.
From where you sat.
From where I sat.
Okay. Yeah.
Inspiring.
Okay. We're going to go right into another clip, which is going to show a couple of the spots that he designed. So let's roll that one now. So you have to get it. We're going to be jumping up and down here a lot because we've got a lot of clips.
There are good men around who have learned that the way to stay out of trouble in a new job is to stay out of sight. These guys become experts at avoiding all sorts of decisions and responsibilities. So naturally, they don't contribute much. But there is a cure for it. You just have to start seeking their opinions. Let them know you really care about what they think.
Hey, what do you think of this?
Oh, who, me?
Yeah, you. How would you like to work with me on this?
And who knows where it could lead?
Some ideas,
that's the way we came up with the first waterproof sandpaper.
You know, you could
and an adhesive strong enough to replace rivets in airplanes.
If you could take
every employee comes complete with a mind at absolutely no additional cost.
Boy, this is wonderful work.
So why not make use of it?
We can reshape the programming.
3M Company.
We can put out twice. That's terrific.
In today's business world, things change fast, and you've got to keep pace. You need to know right now what's happening in your business and what's happening in business all over the world. There's one newspaper that can give you that kind of information every business day. A newspaper that brings to light the ups and downs of Wall Street, the ins and outs of Washington, the different faces of consumerism, first-hand information about the shape of industry and commerce. In the labor market, in the common market, in the Earth's environment, and in the moon's environment. Up-to-the-minute information about anything, anywhere that can affect you and your business. The Wall Street Journal. In a fast-changing world, it's nice to have something you can depend on. The Wall Street Journal. Pick it up at your newsstand.
Didn't you see the news last night?
Too busy. I didn't have a chance.
Ahoy! Didn't you see the news last night? Didn't have a chance.
Hey! Didn't you see the news last night?
In a hurry. Didn't have a chance.
Hey, didn't you watch the news last night?
Nope. Had to practice.
And we readjust. So we're going to talk about the other Hal's partner, Buzz. We're going to talk about him in a little. But while we're on Hal, I want to talk about design a little bit. So, Candy, you told me some interesting things about design and animation here. That animation was usually done for something whimsical and fun. These commercials were for some pretty serious products, things that like normally how it would be people would think are a little too. They're not childish. They're not a kid's cartoon or anything like that, or like a Peele's Brothers or something. So what? Tell me like 3M. You told me something interesting about. Yes. Well, you said that 3M
Well, a lot of these companies back in the 70s. You guys can all hear me, right?
Yeah.
Okay. Do I need a microphone?
Yes.
Probably not.
Back in the 70s, there were a lot of corporations that were getting a lot of grief because they were supplying the war machine in Vietnam. So for the Sunday morning shows and everything else, they would show these kinds of commercials to bolster their image as being good guys. DuPont, 3M.
Okay. Mordecai, you, now being a designer, when you work directly with Hal, do you have any stories to tell about that?
Well, this was a time, and I don't know whether this was being done anywhere else, but I know in New York, and I did it, Hal did it obviously here, was doing animation with other media rather than just ink and paint, you know, in a cell, but working with pencil and crayon and colored pencil, wax, chinagraph pencils to get texture, and animating styles of drawing that had never been animated before, to, you know, to get some richness and volume and dimension into animation, get some richness into the drawing.
Tell me, at the time you were at Perpetual Motion, what was going on art-wise? What was like? Were there? What was inspiring you? What that made you want to push what your style, the styles you were working on, more? Was there? What were your inspirations?
Well, I just always wanted to do that. You know? extend the medium, animate things, kinds of drawings that have never been animated. You know, really just what I said, Hal was doing that, I was doing that, and I didn't, never really worked with Hal directly because we were both designers, so he worked on his stuff and I worked on mine. And he was rather a private person, but very thoughtful and a wonderfully talented man, and again, very original in what he did. His stuff was always recognizable, his way of thinking, his way of drawing, and I very much admired him and respected him, but I think we were trying to, whatever, every chance we got with a commercial or whatever he was doing, to, can anybody hear, nobody could hear me?
Hi. Start off.
Go back to the first film again.
I think we were, I mean, this was for ourselves, you know, whatever we did, we really didn't have that much to do with the subject, you know, or the thing, whether it's a commercial or whatever, but we were really interested in the visual and the richness of the imagery and the movement creating a new a kind of substance, texture, and animation.
Being a designer, we have next. We have two spots that Mordecai designed.
And
can I just ask a question?
Yes.
Do you remember who the animators were on those?
I do.
Can you tell us who animated what?
Yeah.
I think it'd be interesting to know
before
we get too far along.
Okay.
And yes. So for the 3M Chameleon Man and the Wall Street Journal, that's the first two we saw. Doug Crane animated.
Doug. Can you raise your hand, Doug Crane? Yeah.
And the McGraw-Hill spots were all animated by Vinny. Vinny, well, actually, I guess on both the Wall Street Journal.
This is Vinny Caffarelli.
Yes.
Yes.
And the McGraw-Hill spots, I was an in-betweener on them. And on the Wall Street Journal, I did all of the coloring because actually, you know, who knew Hal the best were probably Russell, Tommy, and me in the beginning of the studio. By the time JJ and Marty came along, it was a much larger, well, you knew him from before, but.
I was glad to hear you say he was quiet or thoughtful, because that is my, he didn't talk a lot. When he did, I remember his voice.
Yeah.
I didn't have a lot of contact with Hal Silverman's.
I had to share a room with, I didn't say that right. My first desk was in Hal's room at the studio on 32nd Street. And he had to share a room with me, I guess is how it was, because there wasn't enough room for me and where the normal people sat. So.
One room.
Well, Doug had his room, which was the animation room, and ink and paint was in the back, and there was the editing room, but I shared the room with Hal. And my thoughts of watching him work was just trying to channel him, you know, because he had the most facile line of any human being. I've never seen facile. The most fast, he could pull a line incredibly. Some of us had to work much harder to get that line. And so I would just, you know, kind of sit there and pretend I was him with a cigarette hanging from his mouth. And yeah.
That's great. Okay. So now tell me, when you were color, how were these done? Were you using colored pencils? What were you using to get these design?
The Wall Street Journal was Xeroxed, which was a big deal because they had to go up to Terry Toon's to get the Xerox done. There wasn't a Xerox.
Because at this machine. Time things weren't Xeroxed. They were hand inked.
No, they were still inked.
Right.
And we had a real ink and paint department where they were still doing Croquill and everything else there.
Are there a couple people from the ink and paint department here?
Debbie Lomax is in the back, but everybody else seems to not have come.
Kay didn't come.
I don't see Kay. Rose and Marilyn. But Rose was there from the beginning.
Rose Eng, I think Candy told me Rose Eng, correct me if I'm wrong, was there for the entire run of Perpetual Motion, probably the only okay?
Just I have such a crush on Rose.
I still do. Yay. Anyway, so that was Xeroxed, and there was basically, Doug, wasn't there just one level all the way through?
Yes, there was.
Okay. So Hal decided that he did maybe 12, he did wonderful layouts. And for each layout, which there was plenty of room in between, he picked the color. And then he said, Candy, you do it. So I had to follow through the color, which was petrifying for me in the beginning.
So you're saying there were no Cintiqs or Macintoshes or anything like that?
No, sorry.
Okay.
Also, I want to mention about the Xerox that she was talking about. Because I remember when Al Rezik, who had the Xerox machine upstate, brought it down when we moved to 45th
Street.
Yeah. This thing wasn't a Xerox machine like, you know, you put a thing on. This was this long thing made out of 2x4.
It's like something you put your baggage through in the airport.
It had a big bellows and a lens.
It was 44th Street, rather.
44th Street.
Yeah.
It had metal plates that were electrified. Then you had it made a static charge on it. Then you had to run a cell on it. Then you had to take the cell and put it in this fuser.
The fusing box.
Really had to pour it.
The cell would just all crinkle.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's like acetone.
Explain the fusing box, because I always found, because I came at the tail end of that, like, and I was fascinated that, like, this is better than inking. This is like
Higgins ink doesn't give you that same high. Fuser fluid.
It was a toner.
Beads.
Yeah, the beads. Beads first. That's right. You shook the thing, and the beads would stick to the cell, and then you'd have melt the powder that stuck to the certain area.
That
was this chemical. It was
It's like acetone.
It was like acetone, like nail polish.
You had to soak the cotton inside there and slip it on the tray.
It was more like Bestine than it was. It was rubber cement.
Anyway, and then that came out.
And then 2 days later, you woke up. And
hey, do you remember didn't someone electrocute themselves? No,
not to death.
But didn't that happen on 44th Street?
And they couldn't talk anymore. Yeah, it wasn't me.
What was his name?
I think Frank Weiss got shot. Frank Weiss was working on the Xerox thing. And yeah, he got like some kind of, and he called that thing the electric banjo too. It was this one wire thing, and he was replacing it or something. One of them broke it. Yeah, so he kind of got shocked from that.
Well, actually, we can talk about more disasters.
There was an explosion.
We almost lost Tommy. Yes.
For the sake of a cookie.
Yes.
The editing room.
Was it a really good cookie?
Yeah. It was a counselor across the hall.
No, across the airspace. Alleyway,
the airspace. And I was in the editing room, and I went,
I want a cookie.
I walked out, and there was a massive explosion.
A propane tank.
Exploded and went through the editing room, and shards of glass were it literally would have blown my face off. I mean, it would have. I mean, unfortunately, it didn't, and I'm here. And I wasn't electrocuted. I was thinking, how stoned was I that I don't remember this? I had no clue. Where it was hidden. Or it was, but it was enormous. It sort of walked right by. Oh, that's that mystery that the animators do. Yeah. That was part of Hal, too. I just wanted to talk about Hal, which was, for me, because, you know, it was all magic to me. I can't draw. Still can't draw. I mean, people have tried to blackmail me with storyboards. I would just, and I wouldn't have been able to describe it as he could draw. I had no idea, but I remember watching him draw. And it was so beautiful to me to sort of watch him draw, to watch his hand, to watch him draw. And I think he was probably not so quiet with me because it was like, this guy's a moron. He doesn't have any idea. But he's an unbelievable fan. So I'll just keep talking to him. He would take me to Chinatown. To see those subtitled action movies.
And they were
Chinese.
Really funny, too.
Ridiculous that you go, no one has ever read this. No one has certainly proofread it. I was 26, 20, you know, I just felt so honored to go out. I just thought it was, you know, and he was an artist. I mean, that's what it was like. I mean, for me, and we'll get to this, if you really ask me he was the right side of the brain. I mean, there was this company that had a right side of the brain and this extraordinary left side of the brain, and they made this amazing team together, you know. And there were a lot of people weighing heavily on that right side of the brain. You know, it was like all of the people here. It was like a lot of people, so Buzz was trying to hold this left side of the brain, you know, and somehow went, come on, Tommy, you can do this too. And I went,
What was the first project that you did there?
That I did?
Yes.
I was actually hired as a editor, you know, Neil was the editor there.
But what was the first one?
Candy got me. I mean, I was just driving a cab. And I don't remember where I met.
We met at a party.
Some party. And
he said his name
was
Tommy.
A regular Hollywood story.
He said his name was Tommy Schlamme. I said my name was Candy Kugel and went, ha.
And Candy, you know, was nice enough to get me,
Buzz said he needed a help. We were our only Christmas party at the time. We were all a little happy.
Right.
And Buzz was saying,
wink, wink.
Xerox is for
I was happy.
Shots of best game.
And Buzz said, you know, I can't stand being in that editing room anymore. I need a helper. I said, I got one.
And she did. She got me this job. And so I just kind of, and I remember telling Buzz, I went to college. I've edited a lot of film. I'd never seen 35mm film. I'd never seen it. I had never touched it. I'd never seen it. And I'd go there on the weekends and go, I'll learn how to use this splicer. I really good. So that even if I can't cut, I'm going to look like it.
I remember Tommy was showing me how to splice a film with the tape splicer because I didn't know I never learned how to do it. And I did the thing and then I just cut it again with the blade. I put the tape on and hit it with the blade instead.
We all did that.
I just remember, it was like, that's not the way to do it, is it, Tommy? Yeah.
So there was no real job. I mean, it was just I didn't know what my job was. To help Buzz out and sort of watch these extraordinarily talented people do their job.
I want to show the Mordecai films to talk a little bit more about design before we get to Buzz. So let's watch these two films by that Mordecai Gerstein designed.
Fruit chew. We start with centers, lemons, and limes.
Strawberry, orange,
all different kinds. After a dip, a fruity middle, they all become candy-coated Skittles. Crunch and chew, that's what you do with Skittles. Crunchy fruit chew.
Who woke me up?
Oh, sorry, Cuckoo. It's this cold. I'm stuffy and my sinuses. Oh.
Try new four-way long-acting nasal spray. Nose? It relieves stuffy noses and sinuses up to 10 hours to help you breathe easier so you can fall asleep easier.
Hey, that's a blast.
A blast that lasts all night.
Thanks, Cuckoo. Your timing's right on the nose.
New four-way long-acting nasal spray. The blast that lasts all night.
Animated by Vinnie Bell.
That's where both of those were by Vinnie Bell? Okay.
I think so, right?
What can you tell me about these, Mordicai?
Well, the first one I have... Candy, can you give him your mic? There. The first one I have no memory of doing at all. but I did, you know, I did thousands and thousands of commercials over the years that I worked in the business, starting in... I guess it was 57 when I first came to from LA, where I was born and raised. I grew up in New York, but and that's where I met Vinnie Caffarelli for the first time at UPA Studios, where he was an assistant animator. And I was so sorry to hear that Vinnie is not with us anymore. He was I first met him, and he was just a movie star, beautiful.
For those of you who don't know, Vinnie Caffarelli was an animator who Candy eventually from Perpetual Motion, Buzz Potemkin. This is all stuff that will happen later, but Buzz Potemkin split off into Buzzco and eventually sold the business to Vinnie Caffarelli and Candy Kugel. Vinnie Caffarelli was, you know, my first boss with Candy, and he just passed away this year. So
Yeah. This
is tonight. We also have, you know, we'll be talking about some of these people that have passed on.
But all through, you know, from 57 through to, I guess, you know, 1980 or whenever I stopped working there, and I was doing the Berenstain Bears at the end. I'd done thousands of commercials. And a lot of them were fun, and especially back in the 60s, they were they did 1 minute commercials. Can you imagine a 1 minute long commercial? It was like doing a feature film, and even a 30 second, of course, was like doing a feature film because you had to work with a composer, you had to cast the voices, and work with actors, and so it was. It was fun. I remember the nose commercials. There were a whole series of those, and I had done a whole bunch of those before at Kimmelman, with Phil Kimmelman, and I think even before that, back with maybe I had my own studio for a while, but did a lot of noses, so that was familiar.
Now, working with the ad agencies, how often did they come in with kind of a rough design idea, and how many times did you just have carte blanche to do whatever you wanted to do?
Not very often, but it did happen, and so that was fun. Where we were asked to really come up with an idea, concept, and visuals and design, but most often the agencies had a rough storyboard of some kind. Sometimes it was more specific. Sometimes we worked with other designers, other cartoonists, other artists. For instance, like William Steig, who I had the great honor of working with on quite a few commercials, or Bob Bleckman, or many others that were called in. And the fun was really to work in different styles, all these different styles of whatever was appropriate to the to this particular film, to this product, or something that hadn't been tried before.
Do you have a commercial or two that stand out as your favorites? Something you're most proud of?
Good one. There was a little clip up that we saw here on where there were these flying peanuts. I don't remember what the
Texas Air.
Texas Air? Was it Texas Air? Yeah. But that was fun because we had these flying peanuts. And for that, I always you know, and this is goes way back to original Walt Disney, where he built a multi-plane camera, animation camera, where there was a, usually, you know, in animation you have your, you know, the table, the animation table, and then the camera moves down and in and out, and you know, and that's pretty much it. But what Disney introduced was raising up from there another level of glass, and then on top of that another level of glass, so you get a feeling of great depth, and the camera could move way down. And so I got together. I forget. Was it Dave? Was it Johnny or Dave? What's his?
John Roll.
Was it John Roll? Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
And Buzz.
Uh huh. Yeah. Well, I guess we all worked on that. And to actually to build a multi-plane camera. I think it was the first time that they had done that. You know. Yeah. Yeah. And it was maddening and. But it worked, you know, ultimately, and everybody was great. Everybody's great. I mean, whenever you came up with a new idea, everybody's saying, oh, no, you can't do that. Everybody say, oh, you can't do that. But let me see what I can do, you know. And eventually they would do it. So
that's a great segue to go and start talking about Buzz now, because in a lot of the publicity stuff that you sent, Candy, there was a great article interview with Buzz talking about that very same camera and how the studio really was always up for trying something new, to the point where they would build some big crazy camera and have it sounded fun. It sounded like, let's do it. And at the, you know, anytime people say, because so many studios are like, no, we can't do that. No, we can't do that. And it sounds like this studio was just going for it.
Actually, that was one of Buzz's strengths, was nothing daunted him. And also, for those of us that started with him, nothing daunted him.
Right.
We were all extremely young, our first jobs, and enthusiastic. And if we wanted to try something, we could.
I mean, that it couldn't be done yet.
Yeah.
Right, right.
You know, we didn't, you know, have the idea that, well, you can't do that.
Well, I love how Tommy called, you know, we had the left brain and the right brain. Now, let's play the game with Buzz again. Mordecai, how would you just I'll give you more than two words this time. To describe Buzz, how would you describe him?
Wunderkind.
Wunderkind. Okay, Candy? Look at JJ. JJ's like, I gotta come up with something good.
Gas.
Gassy?
No, what Buzz, when I first started working for him, used to say, oh, you wouldn't remember that. You were in kindergarten. And he was as old as my older brother, right? So after about 10 years, he went, you know that, Candy. And it was something that happened before I was born. But anyway.
Right. Okay. Tommy?
Here you go. I haven't used one of those in a long time. You know, for me, he was just incredibly generous.
Mm-hmm.
Very generous.
JJ?
Direct.
That's a good one.
Direct.
Yeah.
He didn't mince words with me anyway. And but he was always available to talk to. And every once in a while, I used to work with a guy named Jan Spojak.
Mm-hmm.
And Jan used to love the fact that late at night, Jan would work late at night, and Buzz would kind of wander in, and they'd just hang out and talk. And Jan just found that so terrific, because he really admired Buzz's mind. He thought Buzz was brilliant.
Mm-hmm.
And I only knew Buzz as a boss. But when I got to know him a little bit better at Buzzco, I started to see what Jan was talking about, because we had worked on a reel for Pushpin, and which is was a design studio, Seymour Quast and all these brilliant designers and illustrators and so forth. And I had done the reel and exposed it on bar sheets, and I asked if I could go to the final session where the music, we used Vivaldi's Four Seasons as music, and I just wanted to be there because I'd never been to a final session before. So I kind of sheepishly, you know, went into Buzz and said, do you think, is there any way I could go to National with you guys to finish this? And Buzz thought about it and said, okay, but don't say anything stupid. I thought, oh my God. But we all went there, and it was, it was great to see how he worked with somebody like Seymour Quast too. It was all very matter of fact. It was all very natural, and he had a focus which I had not been around before. This is the first studio I had worked at, first staff job I had ever had, so everything was new. But to see somebody like Buzz work was very interesting, because I didn't see him as the left side of the brain. He was creative, but he was also very driven. He was the first guy who had a computer. He used to sit at the desk. He used to sit at that computer. I think it was like
crazy.
A K-Pro or something.
Yeah.
Like I
said, left side of the brain.
Yeah. And he just constantly, you know, what is he doing?
That's right. Yeah, my K-Pro.
No. What he was doing, he had me finding out how much footage people did in the studio. He wanted to know how many cells were whatever. So I'd come at the end of the day and give him the information on the first bears, and he'd try and figure all of this out, you know, how much trouble are we in, And
did you say generous? Was that what you said?
Yeah.
Because I found out later what he was like. Oh, after we opened our own studio, I started getting a lot of people calling and contacting us from LA. And I started asking, because there seemed to be this influx, and 9/10 of them were Buzz. He had just, you know, recommended that, you know, people contact us. And I got to know Buzz later, and it was wonderful. It kills me. He never visited our studio up in White Plains. I would have loved to have had him come up, because I was just starting to get to know him in a different way. But he was generous, very generous.
Russell?
I think he was patient also, because, you know, he was, you know, cat wrangling a bunch of crazy people, and he was patient with all of us.
What about the normal people that Candy said? Right.
I didn't know them. They weren't in my room.
And he kept long form animation here.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
Well, and which another perfect segue. Where Hal began to gravitate, you know, to stay with commercials, Buzz was really interested in the long form. And some of the early stuff for that were the weekend spots that started to happen, which weren't commercials. Weekend was a show that was where Saturday Night Live was on three times a month. Weekend would come on about once, and they would have these little animated bits, and you guys did 200 of them or something like that. So we're going to show a couple. 5 years, you said you did them. So we're going to show some clips from a couple of these, and then we're going to talk about those.
And was this Jan and you?
Yeah, I worked with Jan on some
stuff.
Well,
on the Mr. Hips.
Yeah, the Mr. Hips. And actually, I got to animate the first thing I ever animated myself was for a weekend spot. And
what year is this?
This is 76, 77. 78.
We can watch the clips and you can come back and tell us later.
It might have the copyright date on it. Okay. 78.
All right. Let's roll this next set of clips.
Thank you. is rolling. Quiet, everybody. Okay, quiet, got it. Please.
Oh, 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 oh,
how does your hand go in? How's going to go here? How's going to get to Julian? Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that's
good.
Yeah,
that's
the Glimp TV interview. Your host, Charles C. Charm. His guest, Senator Hoosit.
So let's talk about who did those. Candy, the first one is obviously, you know, like you designed that and animated it.
Yeah.
Okay.
And Russell assisted me on that.
Yes. All right.
He insisted that he could make the dots go any way he wanted to.
but then you showed me how not to. you can't do dots going this way when the character's turning this way.
Yeah. And Yearning to Be Free was yours as well, the second one.
Yeah, yeah. No, wait.
I'll get to it.
I was going to give Tommy credit for the music. You did the music for Fat Farm. You made it even so much better.
Thank you.
But I did the music.
Okay. Yes. The Newsmaker?
Newsmaker was designed... Well, you're need to be free.
Yes, okay. Okay.
We would have story meetings.
Right.
Actually, they've been documented, so I know we have them. And sometimes Reuben Frank, whose show it was, would come up with a list of ideas for whatever it was, and we'd have to brainstorm about how to do it and stuff like that. But Yearning to Be Free, I had read in the newspaper that the Nazis were going to march in Skokie, and the ACLU was supporting them. And the ACLU, of course, is filled with liberal Jewish people, and I thought, well, wouldn't it be interesting? And I saw the name of the lawyer. Wouldn't it be interesting if you were a survivor's son? And so I offered this. And it took 4 or 5 days for people to decide that they wanted to do it. We only had 2 weeks. So it had to be done quickly. And because 2 weeks now with a computer is nothing. I mean, you could do it really easily. But back then, that was a big deal. And we got notice from the ACLU and Yad Vashem, and it's there, and it was a big deal. And Jan animated some of that, so yes.
And that's also to go back to the generous thing about Buzz and about really the whole place, which was, those were the most exciting things for me. I don't remember doing music, I don't even remember, you know, but I do remember it was the beginning for me of this is really what I want to tell little stories. I didn't know how I was going to get there. I didn't know which path I was going to choose. I had a job, so I was so happy right now. But I remember those story meetings that if you had an idea, no idea was a bad idea.
It was this incubator for, and you can do something funny, you can have social commentary.
Up for what a writer's room really became later in my life, and how to deal with a writer's room, and how to nourish people who, you know, I was an assistant editor. I mean, I was just sort of there. I have it, and they were like, if you have an idea, throw it out. We'll keep working on these projects. And then, you know, and it was just, that was for me so incredibly exciting.
Plus, it was a big place with a lot of people doing a lot of different things. When I was there, it was a big place. Yeah. You had all these people working in different areas of production, and the long form overlapped with the commercial department, and you just don't have those opportunities, at least on the East Coast, anymore. You know, it's fantastic to be a part of this huge machine, and. It's too bad that doesn't exist anymore.
Newsmaker, you were asking about.
Yep.
Designed by Dave Morris.
Okay.
Animated by Jan Svojak.
Okay.
And you see,
that's
Tommy.
That's who I was just asking.
Yes. Oh, well, he wasn't an animator, he's a designer.
We're all the same to me. They all prove.
But Tommy has a cameo in there as the editor.
Yeah. And that's how you're really supposed to edit film, too. You lick it.
Where's he?
I have no idea. He disappeared.
Is it David?
I don't know where he's living.
Yeah.
I don't know.
Yeah, he was gone by the time you were there. Yeah. But the Mr. Hip, of which they started a year later than the big project, Jan Svojak did, well, in the beginning, Hal did all of the layout.
Yeah.
That later
his
changed a little
too.
Bit. His design, absolutely.
Yeah, it's all Hal.
And Jan, the first two seasons, he did all the drawings himself, you know, like the jogger, who was incredible. Although Patty is here.
What's
that? It is Jan. It's totally Jan. Patty's here.
Okay. Patty Kilbane.
Patty's first background, and it was a hookup. And actually, about Jan and about Buzz, that party that's in the slideshow, he turned to me at one point, he goes, you know, he's paying the salary of everybody sitting in this room and their kids. He's feeding this whole place. So that was
Mr. Hip, like, there were a lot of those, right?
Yeah, about 100.
Right, of just Mr. Hip alone.
Yeah.
Okay.
About 100 of the other and about 100 of Mr. Hip. And the music was done by a friend of Tommy's. It was original music every month by a guy named Mac McKinney.
That's right.
You claimed you knew nothing, you remembered nothing, and now it's all coming back.
Which one was your first?
The big program. You did a voice on it. Remember it?
The big program.
The big program. The big program. And I think Levy did a voice on it. Is Jonathan? Where's Jonathan?
Yeah.
He did a voice. And Mary Beth did a voice on it.
We were trying to find Mary Beth. Haven't been able to find her. Yeah.
But yeah, that was the big program. That was like the first animated.
But yeah, but you know, it's interesting that even now, like, you know, Saturday Night Live with TV Funhouse, which done at J.J. Sedelmaier Productions, almost the same. I mean, it was Robert Smigel, but like almost the same thing, like different styles, crazy ideas. Like, it's a great. I mean, how fun to be able to just, like, could like an in-betweener walk in and say, like, I got a great idea for a weekend piece?
But it could have.
No.
They weren't that gentle.
There were six of us in that meeting.
Okay, so, and tell me.
It really was, I must say, it was really a small place. I mean, it was not until we moved, and then there was the
at
other.
At 45th Street was
there was
big.
Like a bigger room.
That was 70th Street.
During certain projects, I guess, there were people who did the things.
Tell me about the people you pitched these to at the weekend thing. Like
we were at 48th Street when we were doing most of these things, and at that point the studio was maybe 25, 30 people at most.
And 20 of them were the ink and paint department.
And
the other was Buzz. And Hal and the rest of us, we weren't there anymore.
You know, what's interesting, you were talking, even going back to the working in all the different styles and so forth, that's pretty sure that's pretty much a New York thing,
mm-hmm.
you know, and going back to Hubley, going back to animating with Bob Bleckman, going back to the designers and the illustrators, and it worked off of that. It really all started here in New York, because there's a different mentality of how to do animation here, and also the agencies were here. So that's kind of, that's its root.
Yeah, but you didn't get pigeonholed here. That's the other thing I always liked about it, where, you know, you could switch designs. Like, sometimes I'd be working on a commercial, And then Candy's, we have to get this thing for a weekend done. You jump on this for a couple hours. I jump on that. You're switching midstream, and you're doing totally different drawings, but you're learning how to draw in everybody else's style. You got to nail it. You got to do it. And you know, being able to do a little bit of everything was really the best learning experience. And like after I moved out to California, everybody said I talked too loud. And what do? Oh, I do a little bit. No, you have to do one thing. And it was very weird. In California, they wanted to pigeonhole you, like, you're an in-betweener, or you're a designer.
You're a comedy storyboard artist. You can't do action.
I just animate feet. You know, I just do the thumb. I just animate the thumb on a character. Now, it was kind of a weird situation going out there from here, and we were able to write
everything.
We could write, direct, and we could do anything. We had chances of doing everything at the studio, which was a lot of fun. Yeah. And like I said, the generosity and the patience of Buzz being able to let, I mean, that's the thing, it's like, this is like, you know, first jobs for a lot of us, and letting us be creative. It's like, that's like unheard of in, you know, most businesses, where they would let any just junior person throw ideas out there.
Where did Buzz go to school?
Columbia.
For?
2 years.
For what?
Candy has an encyclopedic knowledge of everything that went on there, just so you know.
What's that?
Major in
Japanese.
And that was the connection between between Hal and Buzz. That's how they got to be friends in the beginning. Was the Japanese art thing? Yeah.
Yeah, and actually, Hal is the one who introduced me to sushi. The first time I ate sushi was with Hal Silverman. Yes.
There's a lot of other things that we were introduced to.
Hello.
Wasn't quite sushi.
It was the 70s. What do you want?
Well, JJ actually.
JJ actually set us up when he was talking about all the different designs, the design stuff before, because what we're going to see next are you had these amazing in-house designers, but you didn't limit it to just having, you know, your house style. You went outside and got other people. So we're going to look at a couple clips of some of commercials done by outside designers, and we'll talk about that afterwards.
Look out, here comes the Chex Press train.
Chex Press, Chex Press, woo-hoo! Chex Press is the feeling you get every morning. Crunchy, munchy feeling, we're on board.
Chex tastes great,
woo-hoo! Chex Press is the feeling you get every morning.
I like rice Chex, corn Chex, wheat Chex,
woo! Chex Press is the feeling you get every morning. Crunchy, munchy feeling, we're on board.
Chex are part of a balanced breakfast.
In business, there are basically two kinds of people.
Priorities,
word people,
options, marketing, positioning, contractual agreements,
and numbers people.
37, 17.65, 50th percentile, 220 million.
The word people had machines to help them process words.
Change a second paragraph, widen the margins.
And the numbers people had machines to help them process numbers.
86, 2,497,322, yeah.
Then Xerox came out with a different machine. The Xerox 860 Information Processing System. One machine that processes information.
Well, I think it's terrific. How about you?
I give it a 10.
Sure, close the deal today. Oh, and I'm
America's top corporate executives are getting big payoffs from reading Forbes, capitalist tool.
So I don't know if you heard the peanut gallery shouting out what those were, but the first one was Jack Davis, Mad Magazine. Second one was Edward Corin. Third was Seymour Quast. And there were three of them. So now tell me about, Mordecai, tell me about, were you involved with any of these outside designers?
Not at Perpetual, I don't think, but I was at other studios. I had my own studio and...
Oops.
I'm soft-spoken people. When I but other studio I worked with got in many places, including Pelican Films, where I spent a lot of time with Jack Zander, and my own Summer Star Productions. But it seems like all of the New Yorker cartoonists were called upon to work in commercials. And so as I mentioned before, there's William Steig, Bob Bleckman. I work with Tommy Ungerer, who was, one of the, he did so much stuff, you know, back in the 60s and 70s. And there's one a great New Yorker cartoonist whose name I can't think of, Saxon. It's Charles Saxon, who did beautiful drawings, and it was challenging to animate and work with his stuff. But it was just always such a pleasure and exciting again, you know, to work in different styles, to try to bring these drawings to life. Because you know people had animation looked like little animals, you know, that wore white gloves with three lines on the back and had four fingers. And it was really back, I guess, at UPA, you know, that first animated Thurber and Bemelmans. And then in New York, in the commercials, they went on and found that there was nothing. I even did a commercial that was done in the style of my, maybe my favorite illustrator is John Tenniel, who illustrated Alice in Wonderland. But we just say there's nothing, no kind of drawing you can't illustrate. I can't animate.
And this is a good one for JJ, because working at JJ Sedelmaier Productions was all about getting these illustrators and designers and getting their style dead on. Now, and very often the actual illustrator designer would either say, that looks great, or like, no, what are you doing to my drawings? Do you remember if there were any designers that like sort of looked at these things and said, that looks nothing like my art?
Never had that happen to me personally. Never had it happen when I was working at the ink tank. And when I would work on spots, the type of spots I worked on at Perpetual were, I think, all designed inside. Maybe there was a Seymour spot I might have worked on.
If you want to talk about the spots that were here, the Jack Davis spot was animated by two different animators. It was Tisa and Vinny Caparoli.
Tisa David, another animator who passed away three months ago. Really like the East Coast's like master animator, one of the few women animators out here. Another generous woman who taught classes at the studios, and just, I mean, an amazing, amazing, amazing woman.
And there should be a shout out on that particular commercial to the ink and paint department, because it was a pretty big nightmare and a rush job.
Holler.
Was getting the measurements for all the boxes, getting color stats, which were very expensive at the time, cutting them out, pasting them in, cutting around hands, on the cells. Yep. I would cut around the hand, slip the box under the hand in the cell, and they were going forward and back. So I had to calculate them getting larger and smaller, but they're also getting larger and smaller, and then larger because they're moving forward. It was
a mathematical nightmare.
And actually, I was...
Whereas today on a computer, you just go.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
Really hard
anymore.
To do.
Not anymore.
But it was amazing. It was so.
And it was a rush job.
It was a rush job. And it was like, but you just put your head to it. You just did it. It was just crazy stuff. Yeah. But
before you had the internet, before you had Federal Express, all the illustrators were in New York or around New York.
Well, Ed Koren actually was living in New York. That was the second spot.
Oh, and Jack Davis lived in like either White Plains or Scarsdale. Mm-hmm.
And he had a place in Vermont as well. But anyway, this was the first animated spot that he had worked on, and I was directing it. I did the layouts, and he said to me as he was looking at the drawings, you were asking, if anyone said anything, and he said, "They look like my drawings." He said, "Was that easy for you to do?"
That's great.
And I said, no, you set it up. I couldn't come up with what you drew. I can just interpret what you did.
And you later did a film. Didn't you do a film later?
With Lee Lorenz.
Lee Lorenz. I thought you did a film with Ed Koren too.
Just these spots.
Okay.
That's all.
Okay.
And what was the last one?
The last one was Seymour Quast.
Yeah, yeah. And he was practically in the studio, so he was hardly.
And most artists are so tickled to have their stuff animated just to begin with that
they're very happy.
They're very easy.
Yeah,
very easy.
Working with Charles Saxon, the first time I worked on a Charles Saxon thing, we animated and in between using charcoal pencil, because that's what he worked in.
Yeah.
We had to be real careful so it wouldn't smudge.
Right.
Then one of the things I did, I used Prismacolor to try to imitate it, and when we Xeroxed it, it looked the same, and that wouldn't smudge. You couldn't erase it either. So, but we ran it past him, and he said, yeah, that still looks good, it's okay. And I remember that was kind of an odd thing to have to do. Charcoal pencil animation. Was like,
do you remember the news pencils?
Yeah.
I mean, those were,
yeah, those
Hal
are other.
Stole a million of them so that we could use them to get the heavy end.
Right, from
the
news.
I still have.
What's a news pencil?
It was from the newspaper.
Okay.
The Daily News.
Yeah.
And it was like,
news on
logo. And it was a nice, thick, black pencil.
Very graphite.
Yeah, very.
And where did he steal them from, though?
The news.
He went over to the news building. Okay.
And if you put a piece of charcoal paper underneath the animation bond and you used the news pencil, it looked like it was charcoal almost.
Yeah, it looked really good.
Yeah.
Oh, also on the Xerox commercial, that was kind of fun because I know you were assisting Vinny and I was assisting Jan on that commercial. But the live action spot in there, that monitor, that's where Apple got their the menu at the top, that was Xerox technology, and this was before Apple was even
In their eye.
But that's where they got their stuff from Xerox. They actually got it from them. So it's kind of an interesting thing.
I was thinking that I'm sure we'll get to this,
working in other people's styles, the big one for me were Stan and Jan Berenstain.
It's funny you said that because you guys are like just reading my mind as to where I go. I love this. You make it easy on me. So we actually have some long form stuff here, and when we have two clips to watch, and one of them is a Berenstain Bear. So let's watch that, and then I want to hear about it.
But Pop didn't hear. Papa was just a bit carried away.
We need a tree for Christmas, a fine fat tree is a must.
Without one, frankly, Christmas Day would be an awful bust.
A tree on which to hang our bells, our brightly colored balls.
And all the other things piled up in closets and in halls.
A fine fat tree to put beneath our 18-pointed star. A tree to show how really, truly Christmassy we are. A Christmas tree and all that it implies.
A Christmas tree and all it certifies.
Piles of fancy presents, seven kinds of pies.
Boysenberry honeycomb.
Crayfish fricassee.
But first of all, my friends, first we need a tree.
Yes, first of all, dear friends, first we need a tree.
We need a tree for Christmas. A pine fat tree is a must. Without one, frankly, Christmas Day will be an awful bust.
But Pa was forgetting something that day. Christmas is more than show and display. It's more than just tinsel and pink plastic stars and stuffing yourself with sugar nut bars. There was something important that Pop was forgetting. Christmas is forgiving. It isn't forgetting.
Welcome to another day in the life of Strawberry Shortcake. And what a day! She's up early, busy as a bee. Big things are brewing, just wait and see.
Smile a sunny morning, la 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 la. La 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 la.
Mailman! Your snail mail is here.
Oh, it looks important.
Special, special delivery. See, all the way from Big Apple City.
Oh, my goodness. But the postmark says this was mailed 6 weeks ago.
Snail mail? She is slow.
Wow! My shortcake recipe won! I've been selected as one of 2 finalists in the Big Bake Off!
Ooh, la la!
And the first prize is going to be a lovely new gazebo. Oh, I can just picture it in my backyard. We'll all have so much fun. But the bake-off is to be held today in Big Apple City at the Little Theater off Times Pier. It's gonna be on television. Oh, I'll never make it in time. Yes, I will. Oh, Custard, you're an inspiration.
Now, if you remember, the letter said Strawberry was one of 2 contestants. Guess who the other one is? Yep, it's that misanthropic fathead with a skinny physique.
The peculiar purple pie man of Porcupine Peak. Lucky Berry Bird, your master is going to a bake-off in Big Apple City. My kohlrabi cookies are sure to win, eh? What do you think? You've tasted them? A point well taken. Oh, I do want that pretty gazebo. Therefore, I shall have to enter the contest alone. Beware, Strawberry Shortcake.
Oh, my. I've got to pack and wash up and make plane reservations and lock the door and thousands of things.
What a day. Hip hooray. She got a special letter and she's on her way. Bouncy as a bubble of champagne. Gotta catch the very first plane. Off she goes. Whoop-dee-dee. She's gonna be a winner.
Now we'll never know who won the gazebo.
It's always nice to know guys who work with Frank Zappa can do Strawberry Shortcake.
So Mordecai, you were about to start telling us something about the Berenstain Bears projects.
Yeah, this was, I did quite a bit of work with, there was a couple, Stan and Jan Berenstain, eponymous bears were named them after themselves, and they had never done animation before, and they were really very sweet people, and they were a husband wife team, and we'd been around for a while. The books were wildly popular. They'd sold millions of copies. I don't imagine there's anybody here that doesn't know these books. Anybody? Anyway, they're still around. I don't know if those guys are still around. But I think that it was, we finally figured out that it was Jan mostly who did the drawing, and Stan did the writing, which was all in rhyme, a la Dr. Seuss, which really impressive to me. People that can do rhyme, I'm just really in awe of, and Stan really did great rhymes. I was not...
You're losing your mic.
Yeah, a little close.
I wasn't crazy about the bears, the drawings of the bears, and they were kind of, I thought they were kind of grotesque. the book buying audience didn't think so, but I thought so. And they were all covered with fur. Their feet were covered with fur. They had claws on their hands and feet, and they looked like they looked more like werewolves, I thought, than bears.
The Berenstain werewolves was the original term, thing, but original books, but they changed them. The kids were being very scared.
Nowadays, the Berenstain werewolves would do really well, yeah. I think. But so they were hard to draw. I mean, they really were difficult. I think their proportions and they were very leggy and had long arms, and the colors were not pleasant to me, their colors of their clothes, and it was blue and red and yellows, and I remember I had to find shades of those colors that I could deal with, that kind of worked together. That was hard, but they were really nice, and then working with the gang at Perpetual was great, and Buzz was terrific. We got a lot of wonderful people to work with.
And can we do a shout out to the background department?
Yeah.
Department?
Yes. And that was Brian.
Linda. Yeah. And,
so, yeah. Oh, go ahead. Are there more?
No, and other wonderful people. I know Svojak did a lot of animation.
I
think Vinny was working mostly on commercials. I don't think you guys.
No, worked. I was your assistant, actually.
Okay. It was a blur. we're working very fast. Yeah. And
how did these long form things come to the studio? Now, were these primetime specials?
Yes.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
So NBC. So NBC came to Buzz and Hal and said, "We want to make." How did
no?
I'm sure Buzz pitched like crazy because he wanted it really badly.
So Buzz came up like he wanted to do these books and said this would make a great special.
I can't tell you exactly how it happened.
Okay, that's interesting though, because I would have thought it came from the network or something.
No,
he landed it.
That's
right. Yeah. The same thing with the Strawberry Shortcake.
No, okay. Strawberry Shortcake was another story. Strawberry Shortcake was already being done in Los Angeles.
Oh.
It was being done at.
I know it went to Nelvana, but I don't.
No. Murakami Wolf had it. And for some reason, Freddie Wolf got into trouble with it, or they wanted to take it away from him. And Freddie and Hal had a whole history together, I think. They knew each other from somewhere. But Buzz got it for some reason. And the promise was he was going to start on it right away. And at that point, we were doing the Berenstain Bears Easter. So everybody in the studio was doing Berenstain Bears Easter, except for Vinnie Caparelli, who did that entire opening himself. He was the only one who was animating on it, and he had Tony Criazzo as his assistant doing that. It took Tony I can't tell you how long it took for him to do that walking around the gazebo.
Yeah,
that was it was totally insane. It was crazy. But you guys should look at the slideshow, because there's predominantly at the party for the Berenstain Bears, there's pictures of Morty and Russell and the cake, because that was the first bears. And
how many bears did you do?
Five.
Five, and how many strawberry shortcakes?
One.
Just one.
Just the one.
All right.
And where was I going with this? I don't remember. Okay.
JJ, you worked at this is like...
That was, Strawberry Shortcake was the first thing.
That was your first job, right. So tell me about as young, bright-eyed kid coming into the studio and your first job.
Well, he was very good looking. And I knew him. Well, first of all, I came for an in-between test. And Russell, John Lopez, Brian Moore, and Don Pointer were all sitting pretty much behind me. And while I was taking the test, things were getting thrown at me.
Like what kind of things?
So rolled up pieces of paper, pencils, and stuff. Yeah, stuff. And so I made it through the test and got called back by, I think, Nancy Lane. And I started, I was sitting on the end of the bullpen.
What year is this?
1981.
Okay.
February 1981. I sat at the end, and there was a tabouret with the phone and I could see everybody coming in, and was like, I couldn't believe I was working there. And I, Strawberry Shortcake, whatever, it didn't matter. I didn't care what it was. I was working in animation. And it was my first day, and Jan walked in, came in. He usually came in at like 11 or something. He came in late.
Well, he was living upstate.
He was living upstate, yeah. So he came in.
But he came in, and he walked by me, and then he came back, and he goes, you new here? And I said, yeah. And he said, you want some advice from an old-timer? And I thought, oh, my God, this is fantastic. My first day on the job, here's a guy who's been working, you know, and he's talking to me. You know, this is so cool. And it's like I put down everything. It was like, well, yes, sir, sure. He said, run, get out of here. Get out of the business. We're all dying. There's an elevator. Take it now while you can before you get
that
bit by the...
favorite
and that, like, just,
guys.
You know... I didn't know what to make of
it. Someone else here who was also my boss without being named pretty much did the same thing to me and said, like, you know, like, don't, if there's something else you can do, do it.
Do it now.
Get out.
Yeah. And
I didn't listen.
To point it out, this guy took the advice and look where he is now.
Tell me about what you were doing while these things were going.
You know, I mean, with the long form, I had nothing to do with it.
That's not true.
It was, well, very little.
That star, you did the special effects for the star.
Oh, yeah,
you
maybe I shot some live stuff.
Because you did a lot of special effects stuff at the studio.
But I do
studio.
Remember about the Berenstain Bears when you were saying, I just remember it was a huge coup for Buzz. I mean, when it was like long form, the studio was going to stay in business, it was really great. Buzz was still trying to sort of navigate me to... You know, maybe you'll be a producer and run an animation studio one day. You know, and I was like, I don't think that's what I want to do. And the generous nature, but I mean, he did know that's not going to work with this guy, but he wants to shoot live action, so I'll try to figure out a way to keep him happy here and to sort of do stuff. But, you know, by that point, I was getting to shoot a little bit of live action stuff for whatever it was, rotoscope or anything like that. So maybe there was snow against.
But we did work together, I think, on the first Berenstain Bears Christmas. I remember on the music, didn't you?
It was a real separate division because at the same time, I think Buzz was so involved with the Berenstain, with trying this long form and making sure this thing worked. And I remember talking to, you know, at that time to me, he's talking to a network, you know, and I thought, now in my life, I'm like, oh, I feel so bad for him.
This at the time was a big deal. This was prime time animation.
Oh, it was a huge deal. And it was a big deal, I think. You know, look, I don't really know, but I think the economics of everything, you know, it was like trying to sustain an animation studio and a large animation studio and an ink and paint department. And
does anyone know ballpark what the budget half a million for one of the, and how long were they?
26 minutes. But let me also put a shout out to Marilyn. Because she and I were left to do the end credits of this because it had to go up in the satellite by 2 a.m. So we were both left by Buzz, because at this point he was spent, in the film to tape to put in the crawl at the end, checking the watch. Can we make it to 30 Rock? Can we make it to 30 Rock? Can we make it on time?
To 30 Rock, uphill both ways.
Exactly.
Through with snow, the rabid ice weasels chasing you.
That is it.
Holes in the shoes.
And we made it on time, and I think that Buzz even rented us a car, right? Didn't we have like a limousine or something?
But there was no gas in it.
and then Marilyn stayed over at my house that night because it was 2 in the morning. But we were expected to be at work at 9 the next morning.
Okay, so this long form stuff is going on now. Then some big commercials came up, some like really kind of national things. Now you know that these came. Were these happening around the same time or after the long?
Oh, no, they happened all the time through this.
Yeah. Okay, so we're gonna show you a couple big spots that a lot of these I remember specifically when I was a kid, like watching like during like you know
and
during
actually,
TV.
Actually, I think in there,
we'll watch them and then we'll.
Hey, who are you? And what are you doing in the mint patch?
We're the Minkins from Beach.com. Minkins put the minty flavor in Beach.com. That's what we do. Clean flavor, fresh flavor.
fresh.
Clean flavor, fresh flavor, only natural mint flavor.
Beech nut, peppermint, and spearmint, made only by
the Mintkins.
You taste 7 kinds of fruit in Hawaiian punch. 7 kinds of fruit in Hawaiian punch. Hawaiian punch is made with 7 kinds of fruit for a one-of-a-kind fruit taste.
Hawaiian Punch Fruit Punch, with 10% fruit juice, lots of vitamin C, and a fruit juicy taste kids love.
Hawaiian Punch is made with 7 kinds of fruit
for a one-of-a-kind fruit taste.
Cheerios!
Amigos!
Cheerios, crunchy, yummy Oreos.
Yummy Oreos!
A tasty way to round out this nutritious breakfast.
Cheerios!
When you want the great taste of Cheerios, just Cheeriodle.
Cheerios!
Never be too thin or too rich. Save 20% on Slender Rolls.
That Slender Rolls commercial, I remember when I was a kid and I had no idea what was happening. Because I didn't know what panty lines were, and I was just like, what? Why? I don't understand. This is a cartoon. Why?
It also looks really big on this screen. On a smaller screen, it wasn't as, you know, obvious, maybe.
Well, on the Slender Rolls, they probably cost as much as the
You were telling me that those Slender Rolls commercials cost a fortune because of all that airbrushing and stuff.
Shout out to Mark Kaplan.
Mark Kaplan.
All of the airbrushers.
Now, this is on cells.
There's supposed to be a shout out to Linda Doria.
Linda Doria, okay.
Yeah.
What did she do?
She helped design it and also did the backgrounds. Not all. In this one, there were other people doing backgrounds too, or did you do all of these?
I think there was another person.
Okay.
Because of that airbrush, now this is, for those of you who don't animate, these were all done, like they were airbrushed, and then they had to be flipped. In order to show, and none of that airbrush could move much. You couldn't have too much airbrush, or there'd be flashes. That's impossible to do.
Vinny animated the whole thing himself. It took an entire summer for him to do it. And Mark, is it not true that he gave the indication for your airbrush on every cell?
Yes.
Yeah.
Rotoscoping, airbrush. It was just
a nightmare.
Yeah, a potential nightmare too of going wrong. But then
the other thing is when you shot it, Johnny couldn't go like this.
Please explain that, because I remember that very well with Johnny. Please explain what he used to do.
Cells.
Yes. So every cell, generally, you know, there'd be dust on it, there'd be fingerprints, even though you polished the cell before it went to camera. So if a cell is used more than once, actually, it wasn't the cleanest room on the planet either.
You're being polite.
So Johnny would take a cell before putting it down and go under his arm to make sure that it was all clean.
It was a flannel shirt, so it wouldn't scratch.
Daniel Esterman was another cameraman who would wear corduroys whenever he shot, because he'd do it right through here. No matter what time of the year it was, he was sliding the cell through there.
And you told me a funny story about the beech nut commercial, that it was all assisted.
Yeah, Dan Haskett, Eric Goldberg. I mean, everybody had just gotten off of Raggedy Ann. So they brought in, Vinnie Kaff, I think, animated it, but I don't think there was anyone in the studio who could have assisted that. I mean, I really think those guys came in and did a magnificent job.
And that was not rotoscoped.
No,
it was all drawn. Right.
all drunk.
And then they immediately left afterwards for LA. You said
they did.
Yeah, right. They're like, we're not staying here for this. We're out of here.
But what was the other? There was another.
The Cheerios. Tell me.
No. Let's talk about the Hawaiian Punch.
Hawaiian Punch. That's right. That's
okay. Tommy that's can right. talk about that.
Now there was live action in that, Tommy. Live Who
think,
of all
way,
people would have done
never
that?
A retrospective of my work. I see the West Wing in that. But the truth of it is, I'm pretty sure it was my first
live action shoot.
Paying live action shoot. You know, it was Bill Baird. It was a puppeteer. Buzz, let me do this. Yeah, and we went to his theater.
But they say you've never worked with children, animals, or puppeteers. So you were right in. You just went right in.
And he, you know, with just a lot of filament, you know, did you know the lifting up the pineapple and the orange, and had to get onto something else, and it would be like needs to thump harder. Those were my directions. Has to really hit harder, because remember, who animated?
Jan.
Let it hit.
You know, one guy's spine to crack when that pineapple hits.
It was a live action shoot.
With computers, they don't understand what a deal this was.
Oh yeah, I mean this was just, we just did this completely monofilament, and then they had to rotoscope every other frame, I presume.
No, I think that they were on singles.
This was on ones.
Those were things I learned. On twos, because most of them done on twos.
Yes.
Tonight in bed, you're just gonna have this flood of like, I remember.
Was the Slender all skip frame, or was that all ones too?
Yeah,
that was pretty
ones
good.
As well. Sorry,
commercials.
No, actually, I'm sorry. No, it was done on twos, and it wasn't slavishly rotoscoped. It was rotoscoped. It was photo roto, but Vinny would
but
then
we shot
redraw
the
photo. Yeah. It was photo roto, so there wasn't anyone under the camera doing this. They actually shot every frame on photographic paper, but Vinny would change the timing and do whatever.
It was just rough, rougher.
Now how about Cheerios?
Did you do that?
Fred McGovgov, I think, might have animated that.
Yeah, I think Freddie animated that. I don't remember who designed it to begin with, but it came to us already designed.
Yeah, so who was Fred working for us?
He had his own studio.
It was his studio. Okay.
Yeah.
What was it? It was McGovgov, Schwartz, Farrell, and Schwartz. Yeah. And there was no Schwartz.
No, he just wanted
to He had a big sign up on 6th Avenue. Said, who's going to give Fred McGovgov $1 million to make a movie?
Down a whole building.
That's great. And somebody told the story that somebody did and said, like ABC or something, what do you want to do? And I think he gave him, who told the story? Somebody just told it to me. You know, like a 1,000 pages or something that was just gibberish. It was, He also did the Bit of Honey commercial that you saw in the beginning.
These are all different time periods, right? So, but as the long form, Buzz started to gravitate more towards the long form. Hal wanted to stay in the commercials. He liked the fast and furious pace of that. And so eventually they started to kind of go their own ways. And one of the last things done in the studio was what we're about to see next.
Oh, yeah.
So next is a very iconic thing. I think everyone will know exactly what this is. So we're going
to
show this.
First we're showing
another spot, and we'll talk about that when we get back. But the last thing I think everyone will recognize.
That's why I'm following you. I'm on the ride. 68, KNBR.
6, 5, 4. We've gone for main engine start. We have main engine start.
Ladies and gentlemen, rock and roll.
So tell me about the spot before the MTV thing. What that was.
Actually, it was somebody else I met at a party.
You were at a lot of parties. When were you working?
I have no idea. And honestly, I don't remember ever going to these parties.
It was that kind of party, huh?
I guess. Dale Kahn, who had his own little advertising company then, was doing radio spots, and I met him. And he said that sometimes he wants animation. So I introduced him to Buzz. And he had this California station, and he wanted to have it fast and furious. And I just come from Ottawa, where I saw that you could put in 16 millimeter film into a Xerox machine and get frames out. And they needed to have it like in no time always. And they just wanted to have some funny stuff because these guys weren't with a crowd of people. They could just get him for like 5 minutes in the studio, and they were shooting stills, and how can we do it? And so I sort of made that first KMBR thing on a shoestring. Russell, were you, did anyone help me on that?
No, I think you just did that one all by your lonely.
Well, I guess so.
Okay, yeah.
I mean, because it was one of those spots also that Buzz wanted to do, mm-hmm. but the rest of the studio didn't have anything to do with it. And then the MTV.
MTV, very iconic.
When they came, it was called Warner Amex. And I think that they absolutely hid that from, were you still at the studio then?
No, but I worked with Dale, I mean.
Yeah.
Through, I mean, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. But the Warner Amex meeting, I know that Buzz didn't want the partners to know about it because he wanted to go into that direction. So I had 1 week to do that. And I sort of did that all by myself, except ink and paint helped me make those mats. So that was good. The rest of the stuff, you know, Sinexes and everything, the tissue paper was crazy.
Who did the animation, the design on the MTV?
Oh no. Rick Ocasek at Manhattan Design did some MTV. They're the ones that made the MTV logo. I was told, do anything you want to in them. And so that's, I did whatever I could.
All the colors and stripes.
Yeah. That was done with, it was watercolor markers on the back of cell tissue paper, because it had to go through, it had to be a bottom and top lit thing, because it had to be done. We didn't have enough time to do an optical. So that's how that happened. Happened. And then it turned into MTV.
When they used to show videos.
Yes.
So.
Did you want to talk about Gable? I don't know.
I don't know what happened. I just know he was a really difficult person.
Oh, he was.
He was incredibly difficult, but very, very creative.
Oh, absolutely.
I honestly think he was manic depressive.
Oh,
I mean, I'm pretty sure.
He had real.
Because there was like these real ups and downs. Because I did these big speakers. It wasn't for that.
Oh, yeah.
I
want
my MTV, yeah. And then I did a few of the talking heads too.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, I want my TVs. But all I remember was. But that was Fred Allen too, then later?
Later was Fred Allen, and, right. And we ended up doing the top of the hour that everybody knows a couple of years later,
right.
Based on the I Want My MTV thing. But we should talk about the other.
So then, Hal stuck went with the commercials, and Buzz went with the long form.
Hal Hoffer
was a producer as well, right?
Perpetual Animation.
They became Perpetual Animation, right. And continued on with doing commercials. Can you name a couple commercials that they did?
Russell was there.
You were there.
Okay.
For a lot. Russell was the blue team.
They took the Cheerio stuff.
We did the Cheerio stuff. I got to animate Cheerio's Dragon. That was one of the things I got to do.
Noche de Gala.
Oh my god. A lot of Spanish language.
I guess you
stuff
went
too.
There too.
Yeah. I bounced back and forth because the specials would wind down, mm-hmm. and then I'd go over to Perpetual. And Hoffer, who the pictures were up there of Hal Hoffer too,
shows.
Big beard. And
if you didn't see the slideshow, they're going to be running in the lobby while we're all schmoozing and talking out there.
And
so
he was like the producer for the commercials. And he would also walk by that desk I sat at with the telephone. And he had a call, I remember, once with either as a client or somebody. But he was listening to the phone, and you could tell he was getting fired up until finally he just took the phone and started choking it. He was down on the ground like this, and he was looking up there, and going like And the guy was still, and he finally just, you know, went. He had a great sense of humor. Great sense of humor.
So then while you were doing, what was happening, and then Buzzco became the other company. So Wacky Wall Walkers,
yes.
What else, what other long form things were done there?
We started with all the cable stuff. I mean, that was our bread and butter. I mean, we did the Wacky Wall Walkers Christmas special. And
bears.
More bears.
More bears. One
fifth,
more bears.
The
play ball
bears,
was
yeah,
done
is,
by Buzz. Yeah. Yeah.
MTV IDs with the marker on the cell.
Well, all of the MTV, yeah. And then we got USA, so we did Calliope and
Playboy Channel.
And Playboy, Hot Rocks. That was a big deal. But that was with Fred Allen. Because Fred Allen then moved in with us while we were still Buzzco.
Was in the Jackie Gleason offices at the end of the Honeymooners you see at the top of the Park Central.
Yeah.
And it had this god-awful
rug
that only Tom Wolfe. There was a shot in Esquire of Tom Wolfe in the 80s. He had the same rug. And then they had, instead of recessed lighting, they had these stalactite lights that came with, that somebody just took like joint compound and just, it was just a terrible acid trip of the decoration. But it was so cool to go up the special elevator up to the
house.
Oh,
excuse me, talk about moving out of there, though.
That I didn't have to worry about. Moving in was...
a trip also.
Yeah, but it was like an overnight thing. All of a sudden, the offices were on top of the park, Omni Park Central, I guess
right?
It was.
Yeah.
But it was a cool space.
So what year was the final, like the breakup?
Breakup 81, 82? Yeah.
So, you know, 12 years, you say, of like, just, I mean, what a span of work right here. So when I eventually Buzzco sold the business to you and Vinny.
I came there
out of school in 1990, and you got and heard all these stories. The reason I'm here is I got to hear all these stories. I got to meet all these people who worked at that studio, Vinnie Bell, Roseanne, Marilyn Carrington, and it was fascinating just to hear all these stories of what animation was like back then. And Vinnie Caffarelli, I said before, was really my mentor, and him passing was really a big blow to, you know, Candy obviously, and me and everyone out whoever came in contact with him. And the last thing we're going to show you is a film that Candy has done in remembrance of Vinnie Caffarelli. So we are going to watch that right now.
you that it would be the last time I'd see you. How could I know?
Next Thursday, then.
It didn't show. And if I knew, what would I do?
The Buzzco.
Walk right through that door and see you over my left shoulder just once more. Some say we're lucky to have had so many years, but still 100 more would quickly disappear. Where did the time go? How could I not know? And if I
beautiful. So, you know, as well as Vinnie Caffarelli, we lost Buzz. When was that?
Buzz in April, Vinnie December before, and Cal the October before that, all within 6 months.
Animator Tisa David.
And my first idol. Yeah. Yes, all within a year. So I'm ready to get rid of that year and
yeah.
To the next. So, what an amazing.
Just while we're on Vinnie, did Vinny ever call you into his room to just kind of bust your chops?
The thing I remember most about Vinny, and I tell the story a billion times with Candy, you guys would buy like 200 cases of champagne every year, and at about 4 o'clock, Vinny would say, "Timothy, load two," which meant. There was a little mini fridge, and the freezer was all ice except for two holes that fit champagne bottles perfectly. So, and then by about five, he would say, "Timothy, fire one," and I was to go and open a bottle and pour a little in a paper cup for everyone in the studio, and everyone would just have a little champagne at the end of the day. And then, and this is my great honor, then later after everyone had gone, he'd say, "Timothy, fire two." And he and I would sit down with, you know, this is my first year in animation, and he and I would sit down with a pack of cigarettes, a bottle of champagne, and say, "Tonight we learn exposure sheets." Every night this guy sat down with me to teach me animation on his own time, on his own dime. I was being paid at the studio $200 a week, $154 after taxes. I remember it specifically.
it
never got old. The sitting with that guy and yes, and he did that for lots of people. It wasn't just me. There were tons of people that came through. Yeah.
He would call me when at the Park Central. I was in the office, in Jan's office, because I was assisting Jan, and Vinny I think was next door, but.
No, I was in between, I'm sorry.
But I'd hear this, Jay. I'd walk over. Yeah, he said, "Come here, Jay." And this was like once a month. And I'd go over to the door, and he'd say, come in here, sit down. And close the door. I'd sit down. "So, Jay, how long you been with us now?" And that was it. And each time I just peed myself. You know, it never failed. But he had, a fantastic sense of humor. Dry as hell. You think he's serious, and he's busting your chops. It was so fantastic.
Yeah.
So
you know, he also, for me, he was, truly one of the unforgettable characters in my life. Truly. But he also was this connection for me. I had gone to film school. I really wanted to be a filmmaker and everything. All of a sudden, Vinny, who was this animator and really great guy and turning me on to all sorts of things. And, but then, he's in a movie. He's in a Robert Downey Sr. movie, and it's in 2 tons of turquoise tonight. And he knows Pablo Fendi's, and he takes me to this party, and it's like this whole other world. And then he's the one who really talked about Stars and Stripes, and Len Glasser and Safety Shoes, and, he knew that I would love... he couldn't wait to show me Safety Shoes.
Safety Shoes was amazing.
Yeah, and he had such a great sense of humor, and also, talk about generous. And, I worked again a different way. I never saw malice in this guy, there was just a spirit of life that you thought, I'll go with Vinny. It's gonna be good. You're gonna be okay.
And he gets drafted, and what does he end up doing? Working in the bar, he always.
That was his night job.
But he always had a great story of what happened.
And he was a bridge between the old days in animation and the new days. So, talking about working with these Fleischer, Nick DeFury and these Fleischer animators and all these people, and he had this great, I think Michael put it in the Popeye storyboard, just fantastic gouache, drawings. He had all this stuff. Every once in a while he'd take the stuff out, and you're absolutely right. I never saw him even close to mean or even, I don't think even angry. He just was always.
I don't think he was really Italian.
Actually, yeah. Michael shows Vinny's collection every Wednesday on his blog.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. Vinny had an amazing collection of artwork from Fleischer and stuff like that.
He had all these great model sheets.
Yeah.
And stuff.
The original Gabby.
He had a lot of original stuff, and he let us copy them and keep them, and it was like,
Superman.
We got all this great
but
stuff.
But he also was, you're right, he was always contemporary. Vinny was like this guy who went, he can know all of this stuff about that, but feel so current right now. And I unfortunately didn't know him near the end of his life, but I can't imagine that he still wasn't contemporary, that he still didn't have that.
He was at
sort
work
of
his last
life.
Day.
Yeah,
I was so happy that I Skyped with you the week before, too. Me and Candy. Candy's like, do you have Skype? I think I wrote that up. And I got to talk to Candy and Vinny like the week before, and it was just, he looked great. And it was such a shock. It was just a real shock, and he was his same funny self, and it was just so good to see him again. Being 3,000 miles away.
It's been an exhausting year.
Yeah.
Well, thank you for coming. I'd like a big hand for these people here who just,